So we have a pretty light agenda tonight, but I also thought it'd be good to run through stuff that some of you already know and we've gone through before, but now we have new members and refreshers are always important. So, but before we do that, there's no public comment. The first thing on the agenda was final site plan agreement with Pequoy about the appeal. So
right. For
those of you who weren't here, a site plan was approved or denied. The planning board denied a site plan for a project at the state hospital, and then the applicant appealed the permit, and it's just sort of been hanging out there. There's been some behind the scenes discussion about that. But we had originally not known sort of what the course was going to be, and then I got a call last week from the applicant, and they wanted to sit down and talk about a new proposal for the layout. So I put it on the agenda because they wanted to go through and have a settlement agreement at tonight's session so they could just move forward.
Yeah.
And they proposed doing duplexes on each of the three lots. So I told them that's exactly what the planning board's looking for. And then I think it was Monday or Tuesday, they contacted me and said, we can't go on the agenda this week, Mass Development won't let us.
Yeah.
Mass Development has said they want to review the plans first.
And then won't let us do duplexes, or just won't let us go this step now?
Right. They wanted to sign off on the new layout before it goes before the planning board for approval.
Okay.
So what that means is we're not going to have a meeting April 24th. So the next meeting won't be till May 8th.
Because
it's school vacation. And Wayne was going to have to be on because I'm going to be out of town, and he is doing the Pulaski Park public meeting. So we decided, since there weren't any permits,
the Pulaski Park, which they don't want us to come to, apparently.
Well, right. Well, you know, they emailed a draft of the schedule, and I immediately said, you know, we don't usually hold big meetings during school vacation week. And so Wayne passed that on to them, and the schedule got set, and so it is what it is. So there are three, obviously, and they're all, as you noted, they're all on planning board nights. So I think they start at 6, maybe?
Six to eight.
Six to eight. So you could go for an hour.
I think they didn't want us there.
I'm out of town for the first one, but I'm going to skip planning board and maybe one of them. I feel that strong.
Okay. All right, so anyway, well, I'm hoping to get Pequoy back for May 8th. Hopefully,
okay.
The Mass Development will do what they feel like they need to do first, and then we can put it on, and then that can just go forward.
You were going to send two files. You sent one, and you said one was forthcoming.
They sent me the forthcoming one after Mass Development said they didn't want it to go to the planning board yet. So I
and
thought
what,
I
would. What was that plan? Was it just?
It was just the site plan showing the, you know, from the plan view essentially of the two units side by side on each of the three lots.
Okay.
And so that would be the substitute as part of the settlement agreement. And then we would sign off on the stipulation, dismissal, and have that recorded, and then they could move forward and go with it. So.
Okay.
So that's that one. So we're not going to do the agreement till later or stop. Don't do that to me. Okay. So then we can just, I could go over, I have a couple of PowerPoints that I modified or so the, to go over the things, for tonight, just sort of, mini training session. And they were put together by the planning CPTC, which is the Planning Training Collaborative in Massachusetts. So they do these workshops with, especially small towns that don't have staff. So board members who are just sort of thrown into this position and no idea what to do, and there's limited staff. There's this group of planners that, you know, put on these training sessions, and they do workshops around the state. And so they published these are mostly slides from them, but I've altered them to make them, you know, focused on Northampton. So let me just see which one I want to do first. And then if in any of these, just if I'm repeating and you don't want to hear something and you think it's, you already know the stuff, just tell me. And I'll just go quickly to the ones I think you are probably familiar with, but, you know, or on the other hand, if you have more detailed questions than what I'm describing, you know, just stop me anytime.
Right.
So I think I'll start with this one.
Is this available in this presentation?
Well, I can email it to you guys if you want it after.
Yeah. So we talked about that a lot, about especially for new members to have something.
Yeah.
So that, I mean, you hear the first talk, there's a lot of head nodding, and yep, okay, I get that. And then, you know, the summer goes by, it's a light schedule, and then you're knee-deep in a meeting in November, and you can't remember what you're supposed to do, what you can talk about, what you can't talk about. And
right.
So it might be helpful if you had something to go back and to refer to.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me just figure out how I'm going to start the slideshow. I'm beginning. Okay. Pretty pictures. Mm-hmm. So just real basic overview, you know, the zoning laws in Massachusetts, we have an enabling act that goes back to 1933. There were various revisions till up through 1975, basically. And what we use in Northampton as sort of our modern zoning that we've been working on over the last 5 years to update starts at 1975. So I just put this up here because it sort of gives a little bit of context for how long we've been doing this stuff, but also that we're working on a lot of non-conforming uses, things that don't meet the old, the zoning that was first written in 1975, because things have changed, or even at that time, they established bigger lots that created a lot of non-conformity. So that's sort of the time period that we look to when we're evaluating projects. And the important roles of sort of these different boards, there's Planning Board, we have Zoning Board of Appeals, and we have a Zoning Administrator, which is a subcommittee of the Zoning Board to review permits and applications for projects. And then of course, City Council. City Council's role is not so much planning, but on the implementation side, since they're the legislative body, they're the ones that adopt the zoning regulations and any other ordinances that might have an impact on the way that we build or use different sites in the city. And they are actually, City Council, if you guys, you may not, or may not remember, there are a few special permits still left in the zoning ordinance that City Council, that are granted by City Council. So I think it's literally maybe two, like nightclubs or strip clubs or something like that, and then other membership clubs. Not that they would be one and the same, but so they do have one permitting role in that regard.
Was there any discussion about them taking the responsibility for marijuana dispensaries?
No. Actually, and that reminds me of the other thing you guys probably remember, some of you do, they also have the special permitting authority for heavy public use, which is the landfill counts as one of those. And they definitely...
What kind of public use? What was that?
Heavy public use.
So the landfill was one.
Yeah.
So those things don't even come before this board at all, the recommendation that just goes.
Right, they could. Sometimes they would refer out. Mm-hmm. Or there might be a piece of a project that also requires planning board, say site plan or something, mm-hmm. in which case they would need both a council approval and a planning board approval. But they're pretty rare. And the other one that comes to mind where both of those are required, the landfill was one of them. And then I don't know if anybody was here for the Elks permitting for their new building,
right.
Pine Street. That required actually Conservation Commission, Planning Board, and City Council for all of that. So, yeah.
Just quickly, what is the relationship between the Planning Board and the Zoning Board of Appeals, and kind of sequentially?
Well, They have separate jurisdictions. The zoning board really looks at particular, well, in Northampton, they have jurisdiction over all the signs. So if you need a special permit for a sign that's bigger than what's normally allowed, they do all signs. They do home occupations, special permits. The zoning board also does permitting for any variation in the ordinance. So if you, or if you have a non-conforming property and you want to expand upon it, they evaluate it to determine whether it be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conforming aspects of it. So they have those purviews of non-conforming uses. And if you do need both those permits, they're separate jurisdictions, so it doesn't really matter who goes first from a legal standpoint. It might make sense, common sense, to have one go to the other, because if it's about a use, then you'd want to know maybe if your use was allowed first before you get, you know, the technical stuff done. And sometimes, we haven't in a long time, but sometimes we've had joint public hearings with the zoning board if there's a big project that would require multiple permits. And in some, and in fact, in some communities, planning boards and zoning boards sue each other over permits that have been issued for certain projects.
Because they disagree on that.
Yes. I don't think we've ever had that in Northampton, but we sometimes go to other communities and talk about how we work together and we do public, joint public hearings, and everyone's aghast, oh my God, the planning board talks to the zoning board. So they are separate jurisdictions, but they don't always get along.
Well, it says Board of Appeal. Do they not also, as they do in some places, become the decision maker of last resort?
Yes, in fact, that's another permit. So for instance, if someone, it's not from the planning board permits, for the most part, those are appealed to court. But any administrative decision that's made that someone doesn't agree with or is somehow harms them, they can file an appeal to the zoning board, and the zoning board hears that. So if they don't get a permit or if they don't agree with the building commissioner's decision, it gets bumped up.
So why didn't people on King Street with the car dealership dispute call that?
They appealed, but because it under state statute, appeals of the planning board decisions, well, that was a site plan. In our zoning, we specify site plan follows the special permit criteria, which means, and filing, which means it goes to court. There are some cases where site plan is considered an administrative review, and it might go to the zoning board, but because our ordinance specifies that you file the same procedures as a special permit, it goes to the court.
Who is zoning administrator? What name goes with that?
Well, they rotate. So there are five board members, and the administrator reviews sort of really minor projects. They're all residential, what we call findings for changes to nonconformities. And the board rotates, so if there's a hearing for that would fall under an administrator review, then they just cycle through and one person handles it. So we have, there's authorization in state statutes to do long-range planning, and that's under the jurisdiction of the planning board only. So that's one of your big, big jobs. And the plan is a policy document that addresses all sorts of elements. And if you guys who were involved in the Sustainable Northampton Plan, you know, we cover housing, economic development, governance issues, open space and recreation, land use, transportation, infrastructure. So. And it has legal standing. It's the basis upon which you can create zoning changes. And the zoning is a tool to implement some of the policy recommendations in the plan. And so and it's important if you're making zoning decisions or even approvals or permits that that policy document is there to provide a rationale for what you're doing in terms of regulatory changes in the city, and lays out future land use patterns and provisions of services, and how, and also is a function for how we develop our capital improvements plan, so where we want to put our money for new infrastructure or for park acquisition or for any other capital improvement that has to do with land use decisions. And as I've mentioned, the purpose of zoning is one tool that you can use to implement the policies in the plan, but it's gets down to the very specifics about sort of what uses are allowed, what the setbacks should be, how big the structures are, what kind of impacts those structures might have on other adjoining properties, and specifically to protect the health, safety, and general welfare of the residents in the neighborhood and in the city as a whole. And here I just clipped to zoning map. You guys have probably seen this, but zoning, you're required to create uniformity within each zone, so you're parceling out different parts of the city, and that's really a distorted picture. Sorry. On my screen it doesn't look like that. I just have a little, you know, this is a snapshot of downtown, so the different colors show the different zones. And whenever you create a zoning district, you have to have the same rules apply throughout the entire district. You can't, except if you have special permit cases where you can more specifically identify what's important to allow that use in a particular district. But you have to have the same setbacks and heights and things like that within each zone. It can vary from zone to zone, but not within the zone. You have to have a map that shows where your districts are if you create zoning. You can have overlay districts, and we have a few of those in the city, which are additional requirements that are in addition to the standard zoning that might apply if you have a natural resource protection area that you are concerned with, or sometimes people use it in commercial districts to require additional design standards or other things. In Northampton, we have a planned village, which is typically zoning districts are single use or a few uses, and they're segregating those uses from other districts where other uses are allowed. The planned village district is a mixed use district that allows housing and commercial. As we've talked about before, and the text is distorted off the page, the zoning also obviously provides for dimensional and layout criteria. Any questions?
Is the historic district an overlay district or something like that?
Historic district is a sort of an overlay district, but it's not a zoning district. So there's a separate statutory allowance to create an historic district. And it's sort of in addition to whatever the underlying uses are allowed, but it's not in the same enabling legislation as zoning. So it's a separate chapter of the state general laws. And you can adopt a historic district based on their specific parameters by which you can adopt those districts. And a separate body has to review those with separate criteria that don't have to do with land use. It's really about maintaining a certain character in a district. So the way uses are permitted are either by right, which means you're allowed to do them no problem in any district, or site plan approval we have, which means the board needs to look at the way the use works on the site, how you get to the site, where the parking's located, how the landscaping is designed. Special permit uses are only allowed if the use makes sense in a certain area, so there's specific criteria, and I think there's some more detailed slides about what you have to consider in special permits. And then the finding, the variance, and the comprehensive permit are not planning board permits. These are all issued by the Zoning Board of Appeals. So a finding is what, by state statute, initially identified as relating to non-conforming uses, that the board makes a finding that any changes to that use is not going to be more detrimental to the neighborhood. So the zoning board does the finding, and then a variance is actually essentially a waiver of the zoning for a particular property within a district. So you go to the zoning board of appeals, and you can only, we only allow dimensional variances, which means if someone says, I can't build my house at the 15-foot setback, I need a 5-foot setback, the board can hear that variance request, but there are three main criteria that allow the zoning board to essentially waive the zoning rules for that one particular property, and the person has to show that they're meeting those standards. We don't allow any use variances in our ordinance, and that's really sort of a wholesale, except for comprehensive permit, which I'll get to next. But so we're really talking about dimensional variances. The Zoning Board of Appeals also issues comprehensive permits, and this is under a separate statute, state statute, with the goal of trying to create affordable housing. And you might hear people refer to it as a 40B project. So under a comprehensive permit, you have to prove to the state that you're an affordable housing developer. And if you're in a community, if you want to build something in a community that doesn't meet a state identified 10% threshold for having 10% of your housing units affordable to those meeting 80% of the area median income, then you have the ability to go to the zoning board and say, look, I'm an affordable housing developer, I'm going to build 100 units on this parcel, even though the zoning says I can do 10. And the zoning board has to review it and look at it, and will likely grant a waiver of the zoning, particularly for communities that don't meet the affordable housing threshold of 10%. If there's a denial or of the permit, the applicant in a community that doesn't meet 10% threshold has the ability to appeal to the state housing board, for review of this. So comprehensive permit obviously has a good goal, I think, from a policy perspective, to try to encourage affordable housing. But it's been used in a lot of places around the Commonwealth to try to force multifamily housing in towns that never have had multifamily housing before. So in Northampton, we do meet our 10% threshold.
What are we at?
I think we're at 11.9, I want to say. I don't have the percentage right, but it is over, it's in the 11. And so that means that no one can appeal to the housing board to have the zoning board overturn a decision. But we still allow comprehensive permits to come through, and we call them friendly 40Bs, because we want to work to provide affordable housing where it makes sense. So I think Northampton's in a good position because we're not up against that threshold where we are forced to approve for the permits. But there also may be situations where it makes sense to maybe allow more units. Now, we might not, so anyway, the zoning board reviews these, but also we require that the planning board give recommendations to the zoning board before they issue any permits. Because zoning board never really looks at these big complicated engineering plans or site plans, so they seek out recommendations from other bodies. And the comprehensive permit process, I was going to say one other thing about comprehensive permit, anyway, well, if it comes to me, I'll tell you. But, I think the last one we have is at the VA, where it's in a zoning district that doesn't allow multifamily, but we're going to have the
Soldier On
project up there. So, yeah, that's all I'll say on that, unless you have questions.
So why was that allowed if we meet our threshold?
Well, because you can still file for a comprehensive permit, and if you are approved by the state as an affordable housing developer, I guess the point, we take a look at where someone's proposing to do a project, and we say, does it make sense to do, to give a waiver of the zoning, essentially? And this is a one-stop shopping permit, so the person only comes to the zoning board, the applicant only comes to the zoning board, and all the permits are granted by the zoning board. So you don't have to go to CONSCOM, or you don't have to go to DPW for another permit. But the reason why we do it is because there may be certain areas where it makes sense to do affordable housing, and it's a nonprofit, they're trying to put in, you know, they're trying to do affordable housing, but the zoning isn't quite right. What we tell people is, we want you to ask for the least amount of waivers as possible. So if you just need a waiver for one unit, or if you need a waiver because you're, you need two curb cuts on your parcel, or whatever it is, you can't provide all the parking. We really strongly encourage not to go for as few waivers as possible, because we still want to get affordable housing. And if it happens that an affordable housing developer can only buy, I mean, some of these properties that they can buy and rehab are not viable for market rate developers, but if they can get a few more units in, then it makes it viable for, you know, a nonprofit who's getting all sorts of grant funding. And at the VA, we did it because it made sense. It was going to be connected to the VA hospital and services at the VA. And it made sense that we were providing this kind of housing that is in high demand for veterans who are trying to get back, you know, into the independent lifestyle. So.
Plus, that will increase our 11%.
Exactly, right, and keep us further away from the mandatory comp permits. So the planning board's role in zoning is to recommend amendments to the zoning bylaws that are consistent with the comprehensive plan in order to implement that plan. You guys conduct public hearings for the zoning ordinance amendments. And make recommendations when other zoning or ordinance changes come forward. So city council, other bodies might suggest changes to the zoning, and then you guys would hold a public hearing or make just recommendations. And act as the special permit granting authority. That's the acronym that the state uses. So you're meaning, as far as zoning goes, you're the granting authority for these special permits and site plans that are required by the zoning. And then, of course, you conduct the site plan reviews. Special permits are determined if the use is appropriate in a given location, and you can only grant a special permit if it's for uses that are in harmony with the bylaw. You can impose conditions to ensure that there is that it's an appropriate use in that particular location. You can create any kind of limits or safeguards that sort of create that connection and ensure that the project is a good one for that site. But the ordinance also needs to dictate at least some minimum standards for approval of special permit. And we have those somewhat vague standards, and sometimes they are quite applicable. But for some uses, there are much more specific special permit approval criteria. So, you know, and I typically try to put those in staff memo, which ones are appropriate, and certainly the general standards too. You need to make those findings in your decision. And the courts have said, you know, if they have overturned boards, if there aren't specific, if there's a specific identification for either denying a special permit or approving a special permit, you really need to go through and say, yes, this meets the standards. So we talked about other limited special permit decisions are limited by the what's in the ordinance. And of course, if you don't find that it meets those criteria, you can deny a permit. But they really have to be related to the standards in the ordinance. Whoa, okay. I didn't know that. I'm just going to go through all of this. Did you guys hear that sound?
Yeah,
that sound effect.
It's like animation.
I didn't know that was coming. Hold on, I'm going to go backwards here. Okay. So site plan review, again, is sort of how the use works on the site. you set up, you establish criteria for the layout, the scale of a project, or the appearance and environmental impacts. Mostly, it's a focus on parking, the access to the property, drainage, landscaping, or lighting. You can either have site plan review by itself or as part of the special permit, which in our ordinance, anytime you get a special, you ask for a special permit, you have to show your site at least minimally. Certainly, if it's a new project, it has to be, you know, full soup to nuts kind of thing. But you can't deny a site plan based on the use that's being proposed if it's just a site plan review process.
When PCOI came for Hospital Hill, it was, it came as a site plan. And our argument, or one of the arguments, was that it probably should have been a special permit. And so.
Right, because it wasn't consistent with the previously approved special permit.
Right.
So that, in that case, it wasn't necessarily the use, it was just, they had already gotten a special permit approved, and the site plan wasn't matching that
right.
Special
right.
permit approval. So again, sort of conditions, and this is not a complete list, I just threw some examples out there. You know, you've many times required the addition of more bike racks or bike loops, conditions about lighting levels or noise limits, additional landscaping requirements or variation in parking spaces. Sometimes there might be a need for dust control or the way sewers are connected. We don't typically require a bond or performance guarantee for site plan. We definitely do for subdivisions. But it's a tool out there that if you feel like a project, you might have a deleterious impact on the neighborhood if it's sort of partially complete and then just left, you can certainly require that there be a performance guarantee. And of course, hours of operation are sometimes considered. So I just pulled a site plan. You guys recognize this, probably. It's the Marriott Hotel site, just showing, you know, here's the egress, parking layout, landscaping around the edges. And that bike shelter, which now I can't remember if there are picnic tables under that one, but it's meant to be a bike shelter.
This is for where?
The Marriott
on
Fairfield Inn on Pond Street.
Yeah. But I think as part of that site plan, didn't we add the bike shelter and all the trees along Pond Street?
Mm-hmm,
and
yeah.
Usually every
and
chance
there's
we
a berm,
get.
So you condition, yep. So right here is the berm that you condition. There's a cross section that's part of the site plan, but I didn't put it in this slide. Well, actually, this is it right here, I think.
Yeah.
The detail of this berm along Pond Street. And then that's this connection that would lead you to the front door, pedestrian connection all the way to that sidewalk on Common Street. So this is actually the permit condition plan that came after the hearing. Lighting plan, you can't see those numbers. So most of you, I think, are familiar with that. So I'll just quickly go through variances since you guys don't really review these, but again, it's just a variance is a variance from the requirements that would be allowed for everyone else or required of everyone else in that district. again, it's the Zoning Board of Appeals, and there are three criteria upon which the ZBA can grant a variance. If the property is unique in that district in terms of soil conditions or the shape of the parcel or topography, if there's a stream running through the front of the parcel, which would push any development to the back and so they couldn't meet a rear setback, that would be a reason to grant a variance. And there's a hardship, but not self-imposed. So, you know, if someone decides that they want to build a bigger house and can't meet the setbacks, that's not a reason to get a variance. And then it has to be done without, in the public good and sort of without detracting from the intent of the ordinance or the public good. So we talked about this, use versus dimensional. And you can't, a variance goes with the land. So once it's granted, it's there. So because it really is about the shape of the parcel and its location in the geography of the landscape. So then just sort of getting into zoning more definitions, you guys are very familiar with this, but I just thought I'd run through this. You know, we have frontage requirements along streets, we have setbacks, parcel lot lines and size. We also in Northampton have zero lot line, which means really zero side setback between two properties. We have a specific provision to allow for that. And then we differentiate between principal and accessory buildings on a parcel. I have no idea where that picture is. That's
kind of interesting.
I forgot to take that one out. So these are just more defined, you know, rear lot line. And we have these little simple graphics in our zoning too. You know, accessory structure, this is the primary structure, frontage of the long street, this is your front yard setback, how far back the principal structure needs to be from that front property line, you have your side yard setbacks, and then a rear yard setback as well.
Does an accessory structure have to be detached?
No, it can be attached. And there are different dimensional requirements for attaching a structure because that could then morph into living space, so you want to have more greater, I mean, the goal would be in our zoning reflects that, is to have bigger setbacks for attached structures than detached. So if it's just a storage space or a wood shed, it can be much closer to the property line. Okay, subdivision control is your other big review, not just the subdivision. So this goes over sort of your other role is planning for the city, but also then reviewing applications that result in new development with streets and infrastructure. So it's really about regulating the layout and construction of roads and whether or not, you know, and access to those lots that might be coming from those new roads. Planning board's role relative to subdivision control, you adopt the rules and regulations. And I'm going to go into this A&R thing in a minute, but determine whether a plan is A&R. We do that at a staff level. And A&R stands for approval not required, which means kind of in a nonsensical way, subdivision approval is not required, which means someone can just, is essentially carving off a parcel in an existing way or street, and it meets all the requirements for frontage on that street, so it doesn't need to come before you for subdivision review. And someone in their wisdom decided to call it approval not required, which really required, which you do need some review. So you guys also review preliminary and definitive subdivisions, and it's really just sort of looking at the initial phase, and we haven't had one of these. I mean, I guess Kensington States was the last one, and that had so many preliminary reviews and then so many definitive reviews that it's kind of got, I think, confused a bit. But we require applicants to come forward with a preliminary plan first to test it out. Does this make sense in this location? Here's how I want to lay out the road and the infrastructure. And if it's a no, then the board has to be very specific about why it doesn't make sense. And then the person would go back, you know, either come back with a definitive plan that's completely different or come back with another preliminary review. And then if the board votes to approve a preliminary plan and the applicant comes back with a definitive plan exactly as shown in the preliminary, you're not necessarily obligated to approve that plan because they also have to meet all the technical details. But you wouldn't turn it down just because you think the concept is bad, because they already went through the preliminary and got the sign off from you about the concept. So it could be the case that someone could file a preliminary plan, and then when they went for the full engineering, they weren't meeting the standards, engineering standards for sewer or water or whatever it is, and so you can't approve it. But it wouldn't be it wouldn't be based on the fact that they're showing a layout that was exactly the same as the one you had already approved or given a concept. Subdivisions our division of tract of land into lots, but also creating frontage so you can create legal conforming lots off of that new road. And the A&R plan is, like I said, you're creating a lot off of an existing street already. So, and that, again, is done at a staff level. We don't, in some towns, it goes to the planning board. At every meeting, there might be an A&R plan, the planning board member or the chair signs off on it. In Northampton, you all have given staff the allowance to just sign off on those in-house. And because there was a change in the state statute, so we basically review the zoning, and so you're not going to really see too many A&Rs. But an A&R is approved only, you have to show that you're on an existing street, or one that was previously approved through a subdivision, or that's been maintained as a public way that predates subdivision rules. And also has meets suitable width, grades, and construction that will be adequate for vehicular traffic, and including emergency vehicles. So there may be streets that are either paper streets or partially constructed, or maybe never fully constructed, that are just dirt paths, and they've been there forever. Someone can't come and say, I want to build a house off of here. I have easy access, because our standards say no, you have to have, you know, passable access, there has to be, you know, emergency vehicles have to come down here, so you're going to have to come through for a subdivision. You can't just show me a survey plan and say, here's my lot, and call it a day. You actually have to go through the process.
And will that be the case for most of those street acceptances that we went through? Have you had anybody come in for
right now for those? Right, so the street acceptances, the one, if the city council approves all of those, then someone could come in theoretically and create an A&R lot off of those.
And that would come to you,
mm-hmm.
and it wouldn't come to us. And
right.
If it came to you and it was on a street that really wouldn't allow a fire truck, you would be able to turn it down.
If it was a street that's been accepted by the city,
mm-hmm.
That predates subdivision rules, and it does, if it goes all the way, well, in this sort of big pass, we've been working to stop the street acceptance length at a point where it's not passable. So I would hope that we would have caught that in before it gets accepted. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if there's a long street and part of it's paved and the end isn't, our recommendations have been stop here at, like, Cook Avenue is an example. So that came just a few weeks ago, where it was paved to the point right at the edge of the old Moose Lodge by Fitzgerald Lake. And we said, that makes sense to accept the street to that point because their house is already off of that. But don't accept it as it turns into a dirt path all the way up through. And so I don't know if that's gone through city council yet, but let's pretend city council said, no, we don't want to go by a BPW's recommendation or planning board's recommendation to stop here. We want to take it all the way up to the dirt path. We would say that it's probably not suitable for pass and that it requires subdivision. That would be my interpretation of that. So I went over this. They have to meet minimum frontage on the street and that has, or on a way that has vital access, which includes standards. I'll just flip through this quickly. Oh, that's the end of that one. I have one other one, but I can take questions for this. The other one's more about open meeting law and conflict of interest. And I won't spend a lot of time on that because I know you guys all had to take that training, but. And so I can just flip through quickly those slides. But do you have any questions about this stuff?
Didn't earlier when we joined, yeah, we had open meeting law guidelines.
Right. Did you guys all get the Dan and Bill and Alan? Did you get open meeting law guidelines? Did I send this to you?
No.
Okay. Well, there's this cheat sheet.
I have to take a course.
Mm-hmm. Right, and then you signed off that you took the course. Was that part of the? Yeah. Okay.
You passed it. No.
On which try?
Not answering.
No, it took me about 10 times. Well, we have a, I can email a cheat sheet, it's just sort of quick bullet points as reminders if you want, because we sort of have those. But yeah, so we, I think it's, the only reason why I thought I'd go through it is just, you know, the one thing, I think the most important thing that sometimes might, you all might forget is, for as it relates to open meeting, is when we have a public hearing, and it's posted, you might run into somebody on the street or in the store, and they want to bend your ear about this permit that they've heard about. They hate it, or they love it, or whatever. You can't talk with them about that. You just kind of have to say, see you later, or hey, how was the beach, or whatever. Tell them that you can't, you know, talk about it, because you're in a role where you're the judge, you're adjudicating this permit, and everything that's discussed has to be in the context of the public meeting and the public hearing. And if you happen to not escape that person before they throw something at you, you can always bring that to the hearing. You know, someone in passing told me X, Y, and Z about this project, and so daylighting it is the best thing to do, because you know, I think anybody who hear, you know, anytime you hear something, it's got, it's gonna, you know, you'll be influenced by it, yeah. So there's that, and then sometimes you all, there are public hearings that get continued for whatever reason, big projects, or it's complicated and you need more information from the applicant. In between the time that you have the hearing here and you continue it, you can't talk amongst yourselves about the permit, and you can't talk to anybody in the public about the permit. And everything has to be brought back to the hearing in the hearing context. So, but then once you close the hearing, the other weird thing is once you close the hearing, you don't have to issue the permit right away. You can talk all you want once the hearing is closed, even if you haven't issued the permit. And you can even issue the permit in a non-public meeting, which is bizarre. Not that we would ever do that, but I'm just saying there's some oddities about it. But, so once you close the hearing, it's fine. You can talk about it. And then certainly once you issue the decision, you can talk all you want about it.
What about talking to someone on the street after the open meeting is concluded? But after, before the decisions?
You know, if the hearing is closed, you can, I have to check on that. I know you can talk to each other. I don't know about that piece. I mean,
that's the best time to take a bribe.
That's true. I'm going to vote this down because I just got $100, but you can't take more than $50.
That would be weird if you could talk to people after it's concluded but not decided.
I think you can only talk amongst yourselves. You can't talk to other people. But the thing that we try to do here is ensure that the process continues, and that we try to limit the number of continuations that you all have for quorum issues, for the public, not pulling the public back to another hearing. And so that's why we do a lot of upfront work with the applicants ahead of time to make sure their permit is as close to being, you know, heard as possible. So that you don't have continuation. But there are those times that, where there is a continuation. And then even the decision, we try to make sure that the decision is done at least on that night, or if the hearing is continued on the night of the continuation. Sometimes it's not possible. I mean, there have been some, like at State Hospital or big subdivisions, where so much information came in right at the hearing or just before the hearing that certainly, I haven't had time to digest it to provide any kind of recommendations about what conditions you might issue. So, and you guys might want to mull it over before you just sort of lay out all the conditions. So there are occasions where you do that, but we try to limit it.
Yeah, that's not the norm. I mean, usually we'll make a decision. And I've been in plenty of towns where the norm is to immediately continue, no matter how easy the project may seem and how informed the panel is, it's that first hearing, they just continue. It's just a matter of course. And so things just get strung out, which seems odd.
Yeah. But,
Can an applicant request that, I don't really remember the verbiage, but that a decision has to be issued?
They can certainly request it, and I think you probably heard that, where I can say, I really, you know, my financing is a problem here if I don't get my permanent start. And, you know, sometimes it doesn't make sense, and the board lets the applicant know, sorry, we're not ready for that, you know. Other times, it does inform your, you know, review process, and you guys take a little bit more time. And, you know, I can think of times where you guys have been in hearings till 11 o'clock and you can't deal with it. The applicant is pleading with you to hurry up and finish. And, you know, I think it goes either way. So it's up to the board to decide, does that make sense?
So there's no
you're not obligated. With
it, yeah, there's no obligation. Yeah. Right. They don't have the option of forcing it.
Right. There are certain statutory limits about when you have to hold a public hearing within 65 days of someone submitting the application. Mm-hmm. So one of the fears is you never want, and if you don't, then there's a possibility that someone could ask for a constructive grant of a permit. Mm-hmm. So if staff forgets to put the project on for a public hearing and 65 days passes, you know, that's not a good situation. Yeah. So there's that limit. And then once you open the hearing, it can be open, but there's also a decision time frame, and I think that one is more like 90 days from the, it might be 180 days or something like that. It's really much longer to issue a decision. It's either 90 or 180 days. But so you have play time, essentially. But typically, when you continue something, you want to make sure the applicant agrees to the continuation. Because then they're not going to force your hand to say, you need to issue my decision by this date. Because you could run into that timeline. Although, I don't think we've ever run into... The only thing I can think of, again, is Kensington Estates. That got continued and continued and continued. But they agreed to the continuation. So we had to actually write up an agreement, a waiver of the time frame to make a decision. But they agreed to that waiver. And so if we are coming up against those deadlines, staff would bring to you a request to enter into an agreement with the applicant to waive the timeline, just so everyone knows that and agrees to this. And if they don't agree, that's the only time, or if they don't agree, I'm not going to waive my thing. Then the planning board needs to act instantly and based on the information in front of you, not what you think you might get, but whether it makes sense.
Right. We've had the opposite when the planning board, when the public hearing was open, we talked about we don't feel comfortable, we want to continue it, and they say, no, we don't want you to continue. Just answer thumbs up, thumbs down tonight. We need to know. But the other way is usually financing.
Force that at every stage.
Well, they have to accept your decision then, even if it's negative to them under those circumstances.
Right, and you don't have to, but if you feel like they're giving you an ultimatum and they're not willing to, I mean, you have ultimately can continue the hearing because there's such a big time between the time you open a hearing. Basically, opening the hearing is the most pressing thing to begin with. So as long as you get in before the 65 days, which we always do, we usually put it on within 3 weeks to enough for the advertising time. So as long as you get in in the 65 days, then your window is really big for making a decision. So the applicant really can't force you to make a decision, but you've been pressured on occasions to do that. And then, you know, if they don't feel like they want to come back, I mean, actually, I think that's happened recently on a couple occasions, King Street maybe, and State Hospital.
Right.
So then, okay, if they want to, then you can decide, you know, which way you want to go. If you want to just continue it, and then they don't really have a choice because you're not going to issue a decision.
Right.
They may not want it, but you still have that wide timeline to play with. And it's not until you really get bump up against that decision deadline that you would need to act quickly. Right.
So if they want a decision, we can decide to continue. That's what you're saying, as long as we're within that timeline.
Yeah.
Right.
Does the group ever, you know, I'm not that used to looking at architectural drawings, not being a builder or an architect. Does the group ever go out and look at these projects together? And
yes.
Is that allowable to just...
It is allowable, and so, and that's another thing I've... I won't go through the slideshow because we've covered a bunch of this stuff, but that was another thing in the next presentation is the things that are not part of open meeting are site visits and chance meetings that, you know, if you had four people from the planning board that happened to be at a party, that doesn't constitute a meeting that violates open meeting. What's that?
I said that happened last week.
As long as you're not talking business, but you don't think you, I mean, why would you, right? Or if it's past business, that's fine. But, so the other thing is site visits, and yes, we do encourage, and I'd be happy, I mean, I haven't done it in a while, because you guys have your own schedules, and sometimes you go by yourself.
Right.
Sometimes we organize a site visit, and we say, okay, we're going to go Saturday or Tuesday night, we'll meet at the site. That doesn't constitute a public meeting, but you can't talk about the project when you're there. You can only take information, and then you bring that information back to the hearing.
We did one for
down by
the community rowing.
Yeah, down by the river.
Down by off Damon Road, we did one for that.
I've done it a few times.
We generally only need if we have access problems.
Yeah,
we
that's what.
We don't know where it is, or a gate needs to be unlocked,
right,
or we need to get in somewhere.
I think most of us probably go around and look at what we're dealing with.
Right. And you absolutely have the right to go. If someone applies to you, they're basically saying, I'm opening my project, everyone's going to review it. So you can go to somebody's property and look at it. You know, someone might ask you, what are you doing here? Well, I'm on the planning board. I'm taking, you know, I'm trying to get a better sense of this project.
Mm-hmm. I remember, was anyone here when there was a gas and convenience store on 5 and 10 going to East Hampton, and the initial plan had light elevations that seemed really heavy, real strong, and they said, well, it was for safety. But none of the people on the board had a sense for, you know, 12 lumens or 50 lumens, what that meant. So we did a field trip, and we went up and down, I think, King Street, to all the different gas stations, to Pride and to Mobile and all with a light meter. Mm-hmm. We borrowed it from somebody. And it was great, and you got a real good sense for what was adequate amount of light, what you need for safety.
And what's too darn much.
And what's too much, and it really informed the decision for, so we really brought their light levels down to a level that we were comfortable with, but that still provided safety, and it's fine. If you drive by there at night, it's fine.
Yeah.
But some of the ones that, you know, like I think the Pride station, it's glowing.
Right. You know, the one that had it, it's unbelievable.
It's just
awesome. Yeah. Right.
But, and so, and any questions that anybody has ever about site plans, how to interpret what's on the plan in front of you, always feel free to contact me. Or if you need, if you want me to go on a site visit with you and explain stuff, I'm happy to do that too. So, whatever you guys want to sign.
I'm not sure if it was planning board or some other role, but I stumbled over email once, not being aware that email between members can.
Oh, right. So that's another thing. Yeah. Right. No emailing opinions between board members. And in fact, even what I've said on a number of occasions, people have questions. If I email something to the entire board and individual members have questions, they should direct them back at me, but not reply all. Because that could be interpreted as having an online meeting and people are asking questions amongst each other.
Are you then though required to send the answer back out to everyone?
Not necessarily, no. But what I could do is sort of collect all the questions that have come in and then put a staff memo out to everybody saying, right, you know, here are some other issues to think, or here are questions, what have you.
Yeah.
If you know something is coming up, but there's been no presentation, no meeting, can you not talk to other people about it?
That is a really gray area, and I would recommend you not doing that. If you know for sure that a permit's coming. So let's say, in the paper you read today, that there's 35 acres or whatever the number is that's coming at the State Hospital. I would urge you not to talk to people about that project because you know it's coming in front of you. You can say, you know, we haven't seen anything. You know, look, keep your eyes open for a public hearing, but you don't want to take information from people about that because you know it's coming ahead of you. If there may be something someone asks, hey, what's going on with such and such, and you never heard about it, you don't even know if it's a real project. I mean, you know, it could come before you, but, you know, there's no guarantee. I mean, a lot of people talk about things that they want to do and you have no idea. But the ones that you really know, I would recommend just, I can't talk about it, it's coming for us. Anything else? Oh, I had on there, you know, we have to do committees. Do you feel like talking about that now?
I have one, I noticed on the tree committee, which I am the appointed person for.
Okay.
Even though you don't have any listed, but
You know what, this is a really old list, go ahead. Okay,
So I went regularly the last Tuesday of every month for a long time, and then a few months ago, it came up that perhaps we had been meeting without the appropriate quorum. So a lot has happened, but we haven't met in like months.
Okay.
And I've gotten agenda, so I don't know whether they're, and I know they were talking about this whole thing with could you do it remotely? You know, could people, I mean, but we may have met for like a year or so apparently, and never had an appropriate quorum. So I think they're trying to figure that out over at the DPW and all that, and what the role of the tree committee is now, given that it's changed from all that, you know, from there's much more for the city involvement in trees now. So I'm glad to continue. I just wanted to be open that I've got a meeting, you know, like, I think we've had one in like 6 months, but there's a lot of going on about trying to figure out how a quorum is constituted, and whether we need to have one, and how many it is, and all that stuff.
Okay.
Carolyn, speaking of that, do you want to explain to the new people about if you miss a meeting, or maybe a hearing's continued?
Yeah, so if you're unable to come to a meeting and hearings continued, we have now adopted locally the ability for you to review the meeting. And now that, we're on DVD today, but now that Northampton TV, cable TV is filming, they give us discs. So you could, if you needed to participate in that continuation, you could review the meeting and then still participate. If you don't review, and then you have to make the announcement. I reviewed the minutes, I understand everything that was took place at that meeting. Then you could participate in a vote for that next continuation. If you don't do that, if you can't do it or what have you, then you can't be counted, your vote can't be counted. You can discuss and be part of the conversation, but your vote wouldn't be counted unless you heard all of that public hearing. And then there's the whole new, I don't know if I'm gonna get into that, remote participation. I'm not gonna go down that road right now because we haven't adopted it. The mayor has authorized it, but each board has to adopt rules for it. It's too complicated.
How about one last thing, associate member versus full member, what people can vote on and cannot vote on?
Yeah. So associate members can discuss any part of any project, any subdivision review, any plan, amendment, or ordinance. But the votes for associate members don't count towards a subdivision approval and then long-range plan adoption. So the planning board is the only body that adopts the long-range plan for the city, not city council. So the state statutes say that associate members votes don't count towards that. And then if we have a full complement of all board members, 7 members at a meeting, and the 2 associates are there as well, they can participate, but their votes wouldn't count towards the final approval. So if one full member votes no and an associate votes yes, that yes doesn't count because all 7 members of the full team are there. And technically, if one full member is not available for a meeting, but there's an associate member available or two associate members, then we should make an announcement at the beginning of the meeting saying which associate member is going to sit in that slot. And you could switch it for each hearing, but it should be done ahead of the hearing just to avoid any confusion when it gets down to the vote.
Because we have not been tripped up, but there's been occasions when we voted and it was a close vote, 5-4, 4-3 or whatever, and maybe it was a subdivision review and we just got caught up in the moment and weren't thinking that the fourth vote was an associate vote, which didn't really count. So you can discuss and you can vote, your vote just doesn't count on just those two areas. And I remember that's come up maybe once in the last 5 years. But.
Right. Okay.
So do you want to go through the committees and force the newbies upon?
We have the Housing Partnership. Jen was the Housing Partnership rep from the Planning Board. Housing Partnership is a separate committee in the city, and their whole focus is really policy and trying to develop strategies for establishing and maintaining affordable housing in the city, and working on getting information out to the public about the importance of affordable housing and sort of anything that relates to affordable housing. The Planning Board has a seat at that. They meet the third Tuesday of each month, and in fact, I know Jen is still, I mean, she's not going to be the Planning Board rep anymore, but she's staying on because they're in the middle of this process. So there's that committee.
Is there city funding?
No. Here's our volunteer board.
No.
Oh.
Review city funding.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Applications.
Oh, right. So if there's block grant money going into projects, they would get referred the applications and make recommendations for block grant. Or if there's a community preservation funding, then, and if it's for affordable housing, many times they'll weigh in on the application for the funding.
CDBG?
No.
But
in that state funding?
Oh, it's on CPC.
What's that?
Oh. In that state funding?
Well, it's funneled. No, it's federal. But there are some state tax credits that they might also provide recommendations on. So, like up at Village Hill, there are affordable housing tax credits that the assisted living developer wanted to try to access. So they got Housing Partnership, I think, to make a recommendation on their application for state funding. That comes through Department of Housing and Community Development. So that's another source of funding where they might, and any kind of housing project. In fact, we worked with Housing Partnership sort of in the zoning changes. We wanted to make sure they were a really good resource. They have a separate housing plan. And there were they had a whole assessment of the housing units in Northampton. And this consultant sort of identified, here are where your gaps are. And so they're working at trying to fill those gaps of housing. It's not just the very low income housing that we need, but it's all this whole range, middle range of market rate affordable. So, and there are all these strategies that the consultant recommended, and the Housing Partnership subsequently incorporated into their plan. It was adopted by Planning Board and City Council. So Housing Partnership also works with the Planning Board in terms of, for zoning changes. So in the urban residential A, B, and C, we tried to get partnership members to come to the public forums and then also talk from their side, provide those data points about where we're lacking in housing and how this zoning change might help implement their strategies in the housing plan. So the next committee is capital improvements. Mark, you're on that still, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's just a seasonal one, basically.
Yeah, I've been on that for a few years.
Yes, oh. Now, how's that going to work, though? He was not as the planning board, but as a city.
I don't know. So you were on it this, so then the cycle is over. Right, for this year?
Yes,
So, I don't know. I mean, you could I mean, at this point, Mark could say, oh, that's okay, I don't want to be there, or I love this, you can't take my slot, or whatever.
I don't, can you, you can't have, can you have...
I don't think we could, I'm not sure that it would make sense to have essentially two planning board members, even though you would overlap, I don't know how, I mean, because you were a mayoral appointment, right?
Right.
So I would leave it up to the mayor to decide what to do about that.
Yeah, it's good to me, both Mike and we talked about it.
Yeah. Yeah, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
So you can't have my slot.
So now that means you have to lobby the mayor and say, keep me on as a business rep. So we have this technical staff review of permits, just a couple board members. Actually, we had three board members, which then doesn't constitute, you know, a meeting of the planning board. But this is really a review at the early stages of projects to help steer the permit toward a successful project. And it's just an informal review with staff and a few board members, and then economic development coordinator, housing person, you know, building, DPW, fire, if necessary. And this is, this sort of feeds back into what I was saying before, is we try not to get continuation. So we try to get the projects at the front end to meet all the standards before we bring it to you. So this is one step in that process. So we had three people. Frandy was on that one, and so that's why the arrow is there. So we sort of have a missing slot. Someone wants. And they meet the third Tuesday. We used to do. We haven't been meeting that much recently, but.
Got another one next week.
We have another one next week, and it's early, first thing in the morning. So if we just, the most we look at are two projects, half hour each. If we only have one project, we start at 8:00. If we have two, we start at 7:30, and it's done by 8:30 in the morning. Then we have State Hospital Citizens Advisory Committee, which is a, Frandy was on that, and you know, that's sort of waning in
very
its,
much so, yeah.
Yeah, they haven't met in
months,
I want to say.
All right, I'll sign up for that. I'll help you down.
Okay, Carly, well, you got that one?
Do you see a change needed for that, though? I mean, it
we still need to have a rep, because every once in a while the mayor or Mass Development will say, let's have a CAC meeting. So we want to make sure that there's someone from the board who can attend those meetings. And they're usually at 5 or 5:30 on, pick a day, any day. It changes. It's not a regular time. So we talked about tree committee.
I will just say that I'm not sure why someone's from the planning board's on the tree committee. I'm glad to continue, but having been on it now for over a year, I'm not sure the connection or the role, so.
Yeah, I think, you know, there was, I think it maybe fluctuates, because there are times when, so there, the tree committee was a new committee in the recent past, mm-hmm. And so they wanted to make sure they got their work sort of, that there was cross, you know, information going across boards and committees. So they're working on a tree plan, and the planning board's recommending removal of street trees. And the tree committee only is focused on public trees. And there were lots of trees being taken down, public street trees taken down. And then new projects would come forward in front of the planning board, and the applicants would say, I want to cut down this tree, but I'll replace it back over here. And sometimes there was conflict with what the tree committee really would rather seen. And so I think it was at that time the tree committee was really being formulated, and so it was, it felt as important to have
more directly than Carolyn just did.
Sure.
The DPW trees get in their way. Mm-hmm. And so I had this feeling in the past that it might have been too convenient to take away trees, and somebody should play.
Now it actually seems, I mean, the issues that we've talked about that have come up actually is the opposite.
Opposite,
that the DPW is very active in trying to plant trees, and the most difficult things we have is people cutting them down. Public cutting down public trees.
People cutting down public trees.
Yeah, and seemingly with no consequence, even in some cases that they had been told not to. Cut them down and it's almost like it's flipped around.
Tree committee should go out and, you know,
well, that was actually suggested more than once, because one person cut down, I think they measured like 90 inches worth of trunks.
Oh,
because they wanted to redo their deck or something, and they didn't, and they just, and they knew it, and they knew they weren't supposed to, and they come down.
And there is no recourse.
Well, there's something apparently the tree warden can do based upon Massachusetts law, like so much per inch or something, or you know.
But even so, the trees are gone. The
consequence to me wasn't anywhere close to what the crime is. Mm-hmm. The punishment didn't do the crime. Yeah, up in Bay State there was somebody that like cut down 5 trees along there, and had been told, you know, there was no like pleading ignorance.
Right.
And just did it. So it's actually turned around, but I mean, the city's gotten much more involved in trees, and I think that's why kind of the role of the committee has gotten, well, you know, we don't need to do that because they're now doing it responsibly, so.
Yeah. Are you looking for people to jump in and raise a hand?
Either now or after I run through the list and everyone has a chance to think about it, but if you've already thought about it, that's great.
I would love to do the technical staff review.
Okay. Is that okay with everybody? Okay. Carly, you want to be a citizen advisor?
Sure.
Do you want to step off tech review or want to stay on that too?
No, I like tech review.
Okay.
I'll do the housing partnership.
Okay, awesome. So Transportation Committee is a pretty active group.
I'm grinning because they don't know that I'm not the delegate. I go and I vote, and they all think I'm the delegate. I didn't know I wasn't the delegate. I mean, I've been trying to get someone else to go. I'm on a couple, but I do.
Are you on the bike head? No, that was Randy too.
Yeah,
you were bike head.
Okay. And
do you want to stay on bike head?
If Wayne would quit meeting at 7 in the morning, I would.
I don't think you're going to get much sympathy on that.
The Transportation Parking is a really active committee. It's not one of the more fun committees in town because you're actually getting neighborhoods coming in to try to get traffic on. I mean, that's the biggest function of the group. I'm happy to say the mayor has targeted some money for next year, and if the group had some funds to work with, I think they could feel like they were doing more good. So,
yeah.
I mean, I've got some optimism about TPC.
Yeah. Okay.
I feel like I'm supposed to be there, it's not a problem.
Okay, she's got it.
Well, but that goes back to the sort of, I either need to officially not vote there. I mean, I've been kind of in that gray area.
Yeah.
They don't end up being like us where we don't vote a lot.
Yeah.
And when we do, it's not close. I mean, it's not like I'm affecting the town.
A swing vote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's just not how that group works.
And then you're on PVPC or no?
Yes.
Yeah, and CPC.
Okay. Yeah, but PVPC, I went tonight for an hour because if it's in, every other month it's in town.
Yeah.
The off months, it's in Springfield, and it's the same exact night as we meet. So there's no way to make the Springfield is impossible.
Okay.
And so I feel like it's just a cameo if I go.
Yeah.
You don't go for the ham sandwich, I'll tell you that. But if somebody wanted to do that, it's an interesting group. If particularly, you know, you're with the delegates from all the other towns, and you hear about. Tonight there was a really interesting presentation from someone at UMass about population studies. I mean, you know, it's not anything I particularly needed, but it was fascinating. And so they do have presentations. They do. But anyone else is going to have the same conflicting schedule
that
I do.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's Economic Development, Housing, and Land Use, which is sort of a subcommittee of council, but it's really broader than just a subcommittee of council. But they review ordinances, typically zoning ordinances, anything that has to do with housing, land use, and economic development. And then also TIF applications, tax increment financing applications, where the city's looking at creating tax breaks for new business.
Do you think I'm on that, or are you asking me to be on that?
No, you're not. Ann corrected me. I wasn't sure. Yeah.
How often do they meet?
It's as neat, I mean, once a month.
Once a month theoretically, yeah. It's once a month theoretically.
I do that.
Okay.
I don't play them either.
Do you want, did you want to stay on that?
I thought I would stay on that, unless there's something else I should be doing. I told you that it got a little more civilized with the new people. They actually introduced themselves.
It was not civilized before?
It was like you were sitting there and you were a piece of furniture. It was a little weird, but it's funny. I think it's changed a little bit. It wasn't uncivil, it was just, you know what I'm saying.
Can I jump back in?
Yeah.
If anyone wants transportation parking, I would be happy to still attend, just for FYI, but if somebody wants to take that slot.
The bike ped slot then, or is that?
Bike ped's a subcommittee, it's.
Right, but I think that's where we officially have an appointee, as opposed to just Wayne being the parking transportation. I thought that's the way it was.
Well, now there's a parking subcommittee and there's a bike ped subcommittee, but those are subcommittees of TPC.
Yeah, okay.
And it's the TPC slot that I think I'm delegated to go to.
Okay.
Not the subcommittees.
Oh, okay.
And if someone wanted to do the TPC slot, I've got just enough interest, I would keep going just because I probably should.
Yeah. And then, also bike ped? Or no? You're saying TPC slot would then also be bike ped?
I would go to do bike ped, yeah. Okay. But I don't think I have to be on TPC to do that.
Right,
because
that's
James Lowenthal comes to it, right, other people connect those two committees.
Okay, and if there, I mean, you know, the other thing is, Bill, if there's, you know, you could also go to any one of these and sort of figure out what makes sense and maybe not be in a subcommittee if you want totally up to you. Or you can even come. The only one I say you can't come to, because we already have three, is the technical staff review.
Right.
But any one of the other ones, in fact, the CAC meetings, I think it would be beneficial if there ever is another one to have more than one planning board member. We don't have to, but certainly anyone would feel, you know, could feel welcome to go to those meetings. Mm-hmm. The mayor's office sets those up, so whenever we're told that they're happening.
So do we still need one for the CPC?
No, Devin is on till, she's officially been appointed till, another year.
So that the red line, that's...
I don't know where that came from. I was just looking at that, trying to figure out, where did that go?
I thought there were maybe two on that.
And probably my column pagination thing. So...
Can I lobby a little more for CPC? Because it's got the police chief, Ned Huntley. I mean, it's a nice cross section of town. They cover parking strategies, as we, the rates on parking.
Parking garage, infrastructure.
But you're showing it that there's no planning board member that's a member.
Right.
Wayne Fyden from Putnam office.
Right.
Serves them.
Right. And you know, the other thing is, if people want to think about it for a while, that's fine too, because, you know, it's not that we have to.
They meet the third Tuesday of the month at 4 o'clock. Right here. So that would be next Tuesday.
Okay. The only other thing is election of officers. Chair, vice chair. We have a vice chair who left.
Jen used to be the vice chair.
Do
Do we have to redo you? Do we have to renominate you to be chair, and will you continue to be chair?
Does me being in the chair follow my rotation? I think I'm 2 years into a 3 year stint.
We do it every year. Mm-hmm. At one point, the board instituted a term limit, because I think Andy Crisco was in it for 25 years. but
it's more than 2 years.
Yeah, but you know, you guys have, it's up to you. I think it's every year that you would, but there's no problem with being nominated again.
Will you accept
but I think
the nomination
we,
again?
Did you think we, last year, we said 2 years for you?
No, I think we were following, because it's a 3 year rotation for members, planning board members in general,
I see what you're saying. It's 5 years.
Five years.
So you wanted to sign up for 5 years of chair?
No, I was trying to think with Franny and Stephen, how Stephen did it for 3 years, I think.
But he may have taken a lot of, you know, an empty seat.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay. So that's fine. Yeah. So I will.
You'll do it again.
Chosen, I'll do it for another
okay.
year.
Okay. Good. Right.
You're chosen.
I'll nominate Mark for chair.
Okay. So I actually have to officially take notes on this. So let me just. Okay.
As opposed to whatever you have been doing.
Words with friends. Is just
like, no, I've been typing in people who want to make sure. Okay. Let me just pull this down to have a bigger screen. Okay, who is the second? Ann?
Yeah.
Okay, now, so I need a roll call. Alan, how do you vote?
Sure.
Yes.
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 Yep.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Dan, you're willing to be vice chair?
Devin, you're willing to be vice chair?
I thought first mover advantage, but I worked for it.
Nah, you got the experience.
I don't know, it's one other thing, but I'll tell you, I don't think I would ever be good as a chair. So if that's the training ground you're after, I'd
well,
say.
Well, how long was Jen vice chair?
Jen was vice chair like forever.
I think she was vice chair for 9 years or something like that, but with never the intent to be the chair.
Well, if I could declare that, I would be happy.
Well, it has no bearing on what happens next. If someone nominates you for chair, you can say, no, I'm not going to be chair. So it's not necessarily precedent setting, is what I'm saying.
If Mark's
so,
not here, does the vice chair?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So moved.
Second.
Okay. Alan,
yes.
How do you go?
Yes.
Carl, yes.
Yes.
Mark.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
That's done. We're done. All right.
I'm going to miss the next couple of minutes.
The next six
meetings. I'm going to call Jen and find out one of the shortest meeting times.
Yeah.
Well, there was certainly talk about the shortest meeting time going on.
That's right. That was a real competition for a while.
Yes.
I have the record. Okay.
Thanks for not having one over school break.
Oh, you're welcome.
Can you review the upcoming schedule, please?
Yes. So we're going to have... that's right. So we need to do this public hearing on the zoning ordinance change, the special permit criteria for B and C. It was going to be April 14th, but because it's Passover, we had to move it. And so we're now the other option is either to try to do a joint meeting at ordinance committee. I think their next meeting is May 12th, which is also a Monday. Or split it and do joint public not do a joint public hearing and have planning board at the May 8th meeting do their version of the hearing and then have ordinance committee do it Monday. I mean, the benefit obviously is for the public, I think, on this one, that they don't have to go to two hearings. But I want to make sure we have at least four members available for the 12th.
Who's
to make
the ordinance committee?
It's a city council subcommittee, and it's made up of, there are just three city councilors. David Murphy's the chair, Maureen Carney, and I think it's
Oh, it, the woman,
No, it's a young
zoning.
It's the Ward 3 counselor, I think. Is that right?
Uh-huh. I can't, I see his face, but I actually don't.
I'm sorry, I'm blanking out on this.
I could do the 12th if you're just looking for a 4 or 5.
Yeah, I can do the 12th.
Monday, I should be able to.
Okay, so John?
I can probably do it too.
I can.
Yeah, okay.
I'm out of town.
So, you're out of town? Okay.
Yeah, I already used your action.
You could do it?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, oh. Okay, so let's try to do the joint hearing then for May 12th. We'll still have a regular May 8th meeting. We might have another permit. I'm hoping we'll get rid of the Pequoy thing.
So the joint meeting, that date again is April
12th. The 12th, and it'll probably, May 12th.
At what time?
It will probably be closer to 5 o'clock, unless they have a big agenda and we can push it back. But they wanted to, I originally thought it was going to be 6:30 for the 14th,
yeah.
And then I was told that their agenda was so small that you guys would have been up at 5:15. So it would probably be on the early, my guess is it's going to be on the earlier end. It could be, you know, closer to 6, but I just don't know at this point. I got to check in with David Murphy.
If it's earlier, it may be problematic just because I'm coming from Pittsfield, so
okay.
It just depends.
Well, you could come late too, because if there are a bunch of people, because it's a legislative decision, you don't have to hear the whole thing. But, you know. Or if it's just impossible for you to make, that's fine too, because we have 6 other people. So May 12th, yes, May 12th. Okay, so I'll shoot for the 12th then for that joint public hearing.
So could you just explain, this is a joint public hearing between the two committees. We're going to discuss these various bullets here.
Right.
And then out of that, there's a recommendation that goes to city council.
Full city council, right. So the ordinance committee, which is a subcommittee of council, makes a recommendation.
They make it with our input.
And with your input, then you also make a separate recommendation. So your recommendation may be different from theirs. It could be the same, it could be tweaked a little bit, what have you. They would want to take a vote after you take a vote. So if you take a vote, then they'd want to wait to hear what your vote is, and then they would take their vote, especially if it's on their meeting night. If it had been a joint hearing on your meeting night, then they probably would have waited to make their final vote till their regular meeting afterwards. Not that that really matters in this situation, but I'm just sort of telling you, for timing, they like to be sort of the last committee that sees it before making their final recommendation to council. And then when council gets it, they look at any entity that has made recommendations, not just ordinance committee. So if Ed Liu made a recommendation, economic development, housing and land use, or if Board of Public Works or whoever, they'll take all of those in to consider.
So it's like a meeting within a meeting. Dave Murphy will chair the whole thing, and everyone will talk at the same time, then they'll step back, and then we'll vote, and then they'll take that information and they'll vote, usually. So, yeah.
We being
planning board.
Just the people who are there.
Right.
So then we have a meeting. Our next one, we don't have a meeting on the
April 24th.
On the April 24th. Mm-hmm.
That's good. Mm-hmm.
No school vacation.
I have a very important announcement. It's almost Derby time. First Saturday in May, May 3rd. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I don't want to invite the whole
family. What's your address?
I'll send you.
What's your phone number? Okay, you guys ready to adjourn?
I move we adjourn. That's what I should be doing.
Can I hear a second?